Perek HaSoich HaSapoilim Daf Tzadi Aleph, sponsored the Rufu Shalema for Rachel Bashashana Esther. There's a general rule that one is liable to lashes only for a lav sheyesh boi maisa, a violation of a Torah prohibition, by way of an action. The Gemara begins with the Machloikas Rabbi Yochanan Reish Lakish concerning one who muzzles an animal or leads a team of different species to pull a wagon by his voice, scolding her when she starts eating. Is he liable to lashes or not? Rabbi Yochanan holds he is liable to lashes. It falls under the category of a lav sheyesh b'maisa because he moves his lips to create the sound. He attempts to prove his opinion from tamura, a verbal declaration exchanging one consecrated animal for another where the one doing the tamura is liable to lashes. The Gemara rejects this proof. The Mishnah regarding the laws of tamura follows the opinion of Rabbi Yehuda that imposes malchus even for a lav sheyesh b'maisa. He learns it from noisar, consecrated meat left beyond its allotted time. There is no malchus only because it is a lav shenitak le'aseh. He repairs the iser by burning it. Otherwise, he would be liable to lashes even though leaving over meat is not a maisa. The next discussion involves a brisa that states that in addition to lashes for muzzling the animal, the renter pays for food he deprived the animal while threshing. The Torah regarding the punishment of lashes states, "Kedei risha so, arisha achas ata mechaivo vi ata mechaivo al shtei rishios," meaning one punishment per crime. How is the muzzler liable for both? Number one, the Mishnah is of the opinion of Rabbi Meir, who holds loike mashalim, one who is lashed pays. Number two, Rava prohibits the esnan zona, a harlot's wage, even for a son who solicits his mother for incest. Although the principle of kamle b'derabba mine requires the couple to receive only the death penalty, it does not exempt the son from his monetary commitment. It only prevents the court from enforcing it. However, the moral obligation remains referred to as lotzeis yedei shamayim. Similarly, the muzzler remains obligated to pay for the food, only the courts cannot enforce him to pay. Number three, Rapapa explains that the obligation to feed the animal preceded the muzzling prohibition. The double penalty exemption applies only when both crimes were simultaneous. The Gemara digresses to teach an important halacha. One is prohibited to bake dairy bread or smear an oven with meat fat to grease the oven baking the bread. The concern is one may eat the dairy bread with meat and the meat bread with milk. The Mishnah Berurah permits it for shvuas only if shaped differently. Torah states, behemalos arbia kilayim. It means one is prohibited to mate two different species of animals. The Gemara brings laws regarding the mating of animals. Number one, although Repapa was machmir, it is permitted to put two different species in the same pen. Number two, Shmuel holds witnesses can testify to an adulterous affair or any other forbidden sexual act, sheyero'u kederach hamenafim, by seeing the couple lying together as if copulating, whereas one is liable for kilayim only ad sheyachnis kemichol b'shvoferes, physically mating the two species. Number three, one can physically mate similar species. There is no concern for arousing improper thoughts. Why? Bavidite torid. He is engrossed in his work. Similar heterim apply to doctors, lifeguards, etc. Number four, if Canaanite slaves tend to animals, one cannot pen two of the same species with one of another species. Now we come to a new Mishnah. The Mishnah brings a machlokas between the Tanakhama and Rav Yosef Rav Yehuda. The Tanakhama holds a worker can eat, even if he only works with his hands, feet, or shoulders. The verse states, Ki Savo Bekam Riecha, did not specify the type of work. Rav Yosef Rav Yehuda holds that he has to work with both hands and feet to be entitled to eat. The Gezerah Shava brought earlier from Shur limits his rights similar to an ox, using both his hands and feet. The Gemara is uncertain what he held regarding geese and chickens that have only two legs. The next Mishnah. Based on the verse, Kisavo Bekemre Yechav Ochalta Anavim, the Mishnah teaches the worker can eat only fruits he is picking. The Torah did not have to state Vochalta Anavim. There is nothing else to eat in a vineyard. Therefore, the Torah teaches if he is picking grapes, he cannot eat figs. If he is picking figs, he cannot eat grapes. However, he can refrain from eating poor quality grapes until he reaches the better quality, but he cannot take a break from work in order to eat. In addition, the Rabbanan permitted him to pick from one road to eat while walking to the next. Also, those transporting grapes from the vineyard to the wine press may take grapes to eat, returning to reload. The Gemara inquires as to whether he is permitted to eat grapes from another vine he is not picking. It is not clear whether the key factor is the species or he can eat only from what he places in the employer's basket. If the worker is limited to eat from the vine he picks then an ox could eat only from a long vine. The ox being in front of a wagon, the workers fill from a vine alongside it must extend to the front of the wagon for the ox to eat. In any event, the Gemara attempts three proofs from the Mishnah that the worker can eat from the same species from a different vine and rejects them. Number one, although it appears from the fact that the Mishnah states only eating figs are prohibited when picking grapes, we can infer that eating grapes from a different vine is permitted. The Gemara infers a less novel teaching. If another vine hangs over the one he is picking, he has to move it in order to pick the one he is working. He can eat from the hanging vine because in some sense he is working it. Number two, the Mishnah states he can refrain from eating the poor quality grapes until he picks the better quality vines. Why does he have to wait to get there? Apparently he can only eat from the vine he is picking. The Gemara rejects the proof because he would have to stop working unless his wife or child was with him. Number three, the Mishnah states that although a worker by Torah law can only eat when working, the Rabbanim permitted him to eat from row to row or returning from the press to the vineyard so that he does not stop working to eat. Gemara initially assumes it is a proof because walking to work is working, and yet the Torah law prohibits him and says he cannot eat because he is not picking from that vine. The Gemara rejects this proof because walking is not working. The Gemara brings a second version, which is logically the opposite of the first, that walking is working, proving one cannot eat by Torah law because he is permitted only from the vine he is picking. The last law of the Mishnah teaches that a donkey may eat from its load as long as she is transporting it. The owner may not feed it by hand because she eats more when fed that way.